Let's create some artificial depth of field in Fusion in DaVinci Resolve. You may want to create fake depth of field either for artistic purposes, if you want to do some foreground, background separation in your live action footage, create some fake camera depth after the fact, or you may use it in case of CG renders to save some render time, create CG material without depth of field, and then at the end in 2D post-production, tune it in and bring it in with a 2D effect. Both scenarios work in a similar way. We need a depth channel or a depth map. I have already done a separate tutorial on creating depth maps in DaVinci Resolve. Very useful technique. You can fake depth maps, you can create them manually, you can use the depth map tool. There are different options to create a depth map. Once we have it, we come to this tutorial where I speak about the differences between different blur tools and what is more or less accurate specifically for depth of field. So you can use something like a regular blur or lens blur or defocus effect, but you will get some artifacts. You can use an VariBlur, which sometimes can be better, or you might resort to external plugins or do some manual trickery to get around some of the artifacts that may appear. So I will explain exactly why artifacts may pop up, what the problems are, and how we can resolve those. This tutorial will be on a more advanced level, and some of this will require a studio license if you use external OFX plugins that's only supported in DaVinci Resolve Studio. Likewise, things like the depth map are only in the studio license, so keep this in mind. If this all sounds good to you and you're up for some advanced fusion compositing, let's have a look at depth of field. I have in front of me a CG render, and I'm not doing this because I want to talk about 3D and so on. I'm doing this so that I have a 100% reliable depth map. So on the left side, you see a grayscale image which exactly shows me how far away each pixel is. And because it's so precise, I can be sure that any problems I'm showing you now don't relate to the depth map, but relate to the procedures and tools that we are using. You could do the same with an AI-generated depth map or with your own map, etc. It doesn't depend on this. I just want the accuracy of the 3D renderer in order to showcase what's going on. For those of you who are using 3D just as a background, the media in has the Z channel here from the 3D render engine. I am copying the 3D channel via copy to aux into RGB channels. That's what this tool does. I could also use a channel boolean or something. And the bitmap then puts it into an alpha only channel. So from here I get an alpha channel, from here I get RGB A if I need this. If you are creating your own depth map or use the depth map tool or so, you will not need these tools, but you have your depth or alpha channel right away. So first of all, let's have a look at a standard blur tool. If I bring in a blur tool like this and bring it into the right viewer and add a lot of blur, let's say this is the level that I want for the background, then I could use the depth map here in the alpha channel as a mask on the blur. But you might see that the result doesn't look very good. And if you zoom in, let's say we zoom in onto this mountain, which is far away, we see that there's actually a lot of detail. It doesn't really look blurry. It's more like kind of foggy. If you check without the mask, we see this is like the level of blur we have on the sky and in the back. And then if you attach the mask, it's almost like having this blur level and then a bit of detail on top, which is exactly what's happening here. So if you mask off a tool, what is happening is the tool is applied 100%, and then there's a bit of blend of the original image as per the mask values. So if you wanted to show this in another way, what does it mean to attach this mask? It's the same as if I bring in a merge, merge the foreground over, and then attach the mask. Or in this case, we need the invert of the mask. So if I show this, it's the inverse. I go into the settings, apply mask inverted. That's the exact same thing as attaching this mask here, same principle. So you see, we are first blurring everything, and then we are bringing in some detailed foreground over it, and we just decide on the percentage of that detail, and that's why this type of blur effect is not very good. The exact same thing happens if you use a lens blur OFX and mask it off, or if you use a defocus effect in Fusion. It doesn't matter what we put in here instead of the blur. As long as we just mask it off at the end, we have this problem. We also have a different unrelated problem, and that you might see if you look at the foreground. You see here the yellow pole, and you see that some yellow is bleeding into the sky. And depending on the blur radius, you may see more or less of that. So if I have a lower blur radius, you see very well that this foreground, even though the foreground itself isn't blurry at all, the pixels from the foreground get blurred over into the background. Again, because of this logic, and one more time, I can set it up as I did before, exact same problem. Right, so this is another problem that happens if you just use a mask on a blur. Let's see if we can improve it. So the first thing is we can try a different tool, and in Fusion there's one tool which does a better result. That's the VariBlur. I bring in the VariBlur, and the VariBlur doesn't just have a mask input, which we know will not work. It has an additional blur input, and we put in a blur image, and then the blur tool decides how many pixels to blur based on the blur image. It's not masking off, it's changing the blur radius. So if I attach this image, we can fork it off to this green blur input. Let's bring this one in, and then we may have to adjust the blur size so that the mountain looks similarly blurry. But now you see something already looks different. And if I zoom in, we see that the detail here is really gone. So we really blur a lot in the background and not much in the foreground, rather than blurring everything and then masking it off. So that's what the VariBlur does. It does take a bit more computational effort, but the result is instantly better. However, the other problem is still the same, perhaps even more severe depending on the blur radius. So if you look at the foreground here, you see again we still have this problem here of the foreground bleeding into the background. So in this case, the foreground is using a very small blur radius and therefore doesn't get much impact. The background is using a big blur radius and therefore blurs in the foreground into the black background. Not the other way around. So you see this on the background, not on the foreground. This is still a problem with this blur tool. The best type of 2D depth blur effects would take this into account, and what they would need to do is kind of layer the image and kind of start from the back, blur the back without considering foreground pixels, and then work their way forward. There is no such tool in Fusion by default. However, if you want to, you could purchase an external OFX effect that can do that, or you can do some trickery yourself. I'll show you both options. So first, let's do the OFX effect. So in my case, I have installed the Frischluft effects. Again, it's a commercial effect, and no, I'm not getting any commissions here or anything, but there is a depth of field effect which is a bit more powerful and can do a bit more. And I just want to show you the difference so you can decide whether or not that is something that's worth it for you. I will attach, in this case, this effect needs RGB channels, so I'm using it from here. Attach it to the RGB channels and bring this one into the view. Let me bring this up so we don't have a spider web here, and move things around a little bit. So I'm using the RGB channels from here. There is a preview here where I can preview the depth buffer, and we see what's going on. Depth nearby. Okay, back to the normal view. And now I'll bring the radius up. I see, okay, the foreground gets blurred. So I go into the depth buffer and invert it. Now the background gets blurred. That's good. That looks good. And now let's blur the background in a similar way. Again, the mountain gets very blurry, but the foreground, if you see here, we hardly have this problem. We hardly have this fringe effect. Let me show you the VariBlur side by side in an A-B comparison. So I have a somewhat similar blur. Maybe I need to blur this even a bit more to have the same level. On the mountain in the back, quite similar. And on the foreground, you see here we have this dark fringing and yellow bleeding, and here we don't. So this is really doing a pretty good job. In addition, this depth of field effect has some options for the iris, and you can get like this lens blooming effect and so on. If you want, you can turn it off, then you're more like a regular blur. Turn it on, and there are lots of additional things to refine this, which is then similar to a lens blur effect, but again, not a lens blur effect, but using the correct blur radius and using the correct layering between foreground and background, which otherwise you do not have in any of the out-of-the-box tools in DaVinci Resolve and Fusion. Now let me show you one trick how you can potentially fake things a little bit. This will not be perfect, but in some examples it may work. I will for this create a very hard foreground background separation. So assume you have a mask on the foreground. In this case, I can get that here if I just go into my bitmap and make this like very hard so that I just have the foreground here like this. And I am now separating the foreground and the background. I will use a matte control for this, or two matte controls to be precise, one for the foreground, one for the background, and then I will process foreground and background separately. If I attach this to the garbage matte input, then you see I can punch out the background, and same here. And for this one here on the left side, I will invert the garbage mat, so I have foreground and background separated, and all I need to do now is merge the foreground over the background and find a way to blur only the background without blurring the foreground, or blur the background more than the foreground depending on your setup. So in this case, if I just add a blur node here, and I'll stick to the simple blur just to keep the example simple, you will see this is not directly working because I'm blurring transparent pixels back in, and you see transparency popping up on the final composite. So what you need to do is first need to grow the edges somehow. So from this image, we need to kind of get additional pixels over here as per the blur radius. And a good way for this is the clean plate tool. This is more like a keying tool, but I can show you how I use it in this scenario. Let me bring this down a bit and attach the garbage mat input, sorry, this one here, the garbage mat input to the clean plate, and in the mask, invert it. And you see we have here the clean plate tool. For now, nothing happened, but if I go here, grow edges, I can do exactly what I want to do. So I can grow into the alpha channel if I have the alpha channel connected as a garbage mat input. And I'm not using the rest. I might bring this to maximum and erode to zero just to make sure I'm not doing anything here. Everything is based on the garbage mat, and then I can erode into the mat. So I can do that as far as I need to. In principle, I can do it to maximum, doesn't matter. And now the blur tool, when it blurs pixels here on the edge, will blur the actual pixels with the extended pixels, and therefore the blur here will be more realistic, and then as I bring it over, it looks like this. Now, of course, we have now the hard transition here because I created a hard mask, because this clean plate extension will not really work with a soft mask, or it will get more difficult. So I've done this with a hard one foreground picture, one background picture, and then you can set this up. In this particular example, it will not work here, but if you have an image where the foreground is clearly separated from the background, like if I just zoom into this area, for such an image it would work. I have a clear foreground mask, the rest is background. I'm making a hole into the background here, then I'm extending into that hole, blurring over it, and this is the image I'm merging back with the foreground. And this approach is working if I don't see the transition between foreground and background. If I do see the transition, I could still try some tricks with other masks and VariBlur, or set this up in multiple layers and so on. But if you're doing this repeatedly, you're probably better off purchasing a plugin. Case in point, with a live action footage, I used a magic mask here to create the depth map. So essentially the magic mask is extracting her, And then for the background, I'm using a matte control to punch her out of the background, use a clean plate to fill her in, then use a lens blur to make everything blurry based on this, and then merge her from the magic mask, merge her on top without the blur, and this way I have created my lens blur effect in this case. And if you compare this up here, I've done a lens blur which I've just masked off with the magic mask, and you can see the difference. So here you get really bad edge artifacts. Here it looks much better to the degree that the magic mask is accurate. And that's it for this tutorial. I hope you found it useful and learned something new. As always, I have both beginner-friendly and more advanced compositing courses on my website vfxstudy.com. And let me know in the comments if this was useful. What else do you need? Do you have a different approach to the same topic? That's always great to hear. Let me know and see you next time.